Okay, ladies and gentlemen, so welcome back to class. Congratulations on finishing your first of, well, how many nano quizzes? Like five, six, I think? I forget. Ten. I think ten. Yeah, I'm sorry, you know, obviously the greater than one, they're all kind of the same. Continuing in announcements for this class, you know that your first homework is due tomorrow. Let me repeat, your first homework is due at 8 o'clock p.m. tomorrow. If you turn it in at 8:01 tomorrow, your life isn't over. However, you will lose one of your late days. Remember, that's our policy. So we're going to just do it like by the minute, because otherwise I'm going to have to deal with a bunch of emails that I don't want to deal with all the reasons why you couldn't turn it in on time. So if you're nervous about turning it in on time, may I suggest turning it in at 7. So put it out. Are there any questions about homework 1, your submission? Any answers from the TAs about that? So I know that some of you that turned in homework 0 turned in executables that didn't actually run on the Athena machines. You should know that not all Linux executables are created equal. So like, you really have to compile it and run it on the Athena machines. This is not the same as compiling and running on any Linux computer, specifically the Athena ones. Alright? Yes?
Will we be told if they did not?
Yeah, we'll tell you by removing points.
Yeah.
So I think you guys can send them feedback if they didn't.
I rated yours, and yours didn't run. You should have gotten an email from me saying that your executable did not run.
There you go. You
heard
it from
Linda.
Sure
about you. Yeah. Just check your grade. If you're before Angela Lin on the grade list in terms of alphabetical wise, check your grade book. If you're after Angela Lin.
Okay.
Including Angela Lin, you can find an email.
Let's be safe. Check your email and your gradebook, and there will be feedback in one of those two places, and we'll talk to our TAs about unifying it. So turn in your stuff by 8 o'clock or expect to use a late day. Unfortunately, if you added this class late, I had many late nights of thinking about the best way to treat you, and out of fairness to the other students in this class, what I came up with was, sorry, you still have to turn in your homework on time. So if you added this class late, you're welcome to turn in your homework late, but you will have to use your late days. It's only fair, because otherwise, why wouldn't you guys just wait till the last second to add this class? Okay, are there any questions about your homework? And then the next one will go out tomorrow. I will be editing that document any moment now. Starting from now on, your homeworks will be on this nice two-week interval, so we won't have this kind of crazy first week or two. Cool? All right, any other logistical questions?
Are nano quizzes comprehensive? Like, are they cumulative? Or is it just like section?
I'll say yes, just to be safe. They're cumulative. Nano quizzes can cover anything. Sure. You know, anytime you guys ask me questions about, like, what am I responsible for, my answer is always going to be everything. Because otherwise, why would I be here? Yeah? Okay. Great. Well, if there are no other questions, then we're going to start with today's lecture. So, in a sense, I think the way that 837 is organized, somehow you get a lot of the hard stuff out of the way in literally the first two technical lectures, and then all of a sudden you're home free for a little while. So to me, actually, I think today's contents are sort of conceptually easier, although your instructor is slightly dyslexic, which is going to make getting which direction your multiplies go a little bit challenging for me today. But I'm going to give it a shot. So we're going to be talking about coordinates and transformations, which is sort of the bread and butter of all computer graphic systems, whether you're writing a ray tracer or Adobe Illustrator or something in OpenGL. No matter what, you're going to be dealing with all kinds of coordinate systems. And so really, the way I think about this stuff is that it's really just bookkeeping for computer graphics, right? As we talk about shapes and how we draw them and where we put them, we really have to be quite careful about, you know, understanding where they are relative to each other. And that in itself seems like an obvious statement, but it turns out it's really actually the baseline for how we engineer computer graphic systems. Okay. So the basic topic of today's lecture and Thursday lecture, by the way, another announcement. Unfortunately, your professor has to fly to Austria and back over the next 3 days to give a talk. So on Thursday, we'll have a substitute lecturer who's postdoc in the computer graphics group and Wojciech's group. Because of that, I do not know if it will be filled or not. That's up to Bo and whether he likes to see himself on the internet. Yeah. Okay. So we're going to talk about hierarchical modeling. And the idea is that there are lots and lots and lots of coordinate systems in computer graphics. Right? So like if I try to build a human model, maybe I first build a hand, and then I attach the hand onto the arm, and then I attach the arm onto the body, and so on. And so every one of those might be centered in the middle of my computer screen when I'm modeling it. And then I have to place the whole object in the context of some larger thing that I'm building. Right? And that's like a really common pattern in the computer graphics world, and we call that hierarchical modeling. Right? So for instance, in this scene here, the different coordinate systems we might have include the camera and the static scene, you know, just kind of like standing back here and looking at it, the coordinate system of the car, the driver, his arm, his hand, all of these different things. And probably want to put them all in different places relative to each other. Yeah? Like when I say, you know, move your hand to the left, I don't say like move it, you know, some vector relative to the position of the door, right? That would be a very weird way to communicate. Okay. And then beyond that, to really drive home this point that coordinate systems matter, let's say that I drew you this very zen scene with the grass and the stones and things, and I asked you, where's the origin? I don't think there's a clear answer to that, right? Like, it totally depends on the artist, right? So in particular, you know, if I then zoom out in my scene, maybe the origin has changed, to, you know, and was it in the center of the window before? Well, that just moved. You know, if I zoom out, whoa, even farther, effectively the same. Into space, the coordinate system changes in each one of these things, right? And it would be very difficult, for example, to model the entire world in the coordinate system of that astronaut there. Okay. So another way of putting that is that rarely do we ever use absolute positions in real life. By the way, I'm just realizing I forgot to post the slides online, and I apologize. But next time, I'll turn around. Right at the beginning of lecture, if you don't see them there, if you just bother me, I'll do it. Sorry. Right. So anyway, rarely do we use absolute positions. We talk about stuff relative to everything else very frequently. And so today we're going to try and formalize what that means in slightly mathematical language. Okay. So first of all, we typically talk about points, and we when we talk about them in calculus class, we use coordinates, right? So for instance, this thing, this tuple 1, 2, is a position on the plane, right? But really, these tuples are meaningless without a coordinate system, right? In particular, you know, maybe I have two different coordinate systems, like the blue axes and the red axes, and I ask for the point 1, 2. Obviously, that's a different point in these two frames, right? And so when I give you a tuple, implicitly or explicitly, I'm actually referring to some frame that I have in my head, right? And that's going to be the really key way to think about coordinates and transformations in the computer graphics world. Right, so today we're going to talk about a lot of different points and how to relate them to one another. So we'll start by talking about points. We'll move to vectors, which are not the same thing, despite the fact that they both are written as tuples of numbers in calculus class. We'll talk about normals, which are unit-length vectors, right? So in your assignment that's due tomorrow, you already kind of computed some basic normals. You didn't need all the math from here to do that. And then finally, we'll talk about coordinates, which are, you know, specific to a coordinate system. Now you can start to put some numbers to these geometric functions. Yeah. So these are things that I think we all kind of intuitively know about, but we tend to kind of jumble them all together when we talk about them in calculus class. But for a computer graphics system, like for instance, when you're engineering your data types, it's very important to get all these things straight in your head. And we'll see that when we talk about homogeneous coordinates. So the first point, one thing that we should talk about is that points and vectors are completely different things. In particular, the point zero maybe doesn't have a very special meaning, right? This is what I argued to you before, that the origin depends on the artist or the eye of the beholder rather than there being some specific origin. Whereas the zero vector really does have a meaning, right? The zero vector means don't move. Yeah. And so again, I think these are all things we already kind of know. But for instance, it makes sense to add vectors, right? It makes sense to add displacements, but adding points really doesn't, right? Like taking the position of Boston, adding it to the position of New York really has no meaning, despite the fact that people in deep learning like to do this kind of work. Okay, so another way of understanding that, of course, is that, you know, if I'm thinking about a moving car, the point can be the location of the car, whereas vectors can describe, you know, how fast the car is moving and in what direction. Okay. So, you know, just like in the last lectures when we talked about splines, essentially we're going to build stuff from the bottom up, right? We're going to talk about points and vectors, and then we're going to talk about how to change them around, right? And how we change them around, at least in a linear algebra way, is what piece of machinery? What type of object changes vectors? Matrix. Yeah, matrices act on them. Yeah? And so the way to think about matrices is that really they have two dual purposes, and really these are the same purpose, it's just they kind of depend on how you think about what a matrix is doing. On the one hand, you can think of a matrix as acting on points and transforming them,
right? I take points, I multiply them by a matrix, I get a new set of points that's somehow, you know, stretched or rotated or whatever. Or I can think of the matrix as changing coordinates, right? That, well, it's the same point, but I'm moving the x's. Do you see how these are kind of dual pictures that involve sort of the inverses of each other? Right? In one case, I'm fixing the x's and moving the point. In the other case, I'm fixing the point and moving the x's. But in either case, things change. Yeah? And so we're going to try and make this kind of intuition formal in our lecture today. In particular, we're going to define what does it mean to have a coordinate system, what does it mean to change coordinate systems, how can we transform objects. And throughout the lecture, we're going to try and keep the differences between points, vectors, normals, and their coordinates very, very explicit, rather than jumbling them all together into, like, you know, this corny notation, right? Like this thing. Right? So we're going to try and break that down. Okay. All right. I think we've moved our time. Okay. So first of all, you know, just like in linear algebra class, I'm going to do a little bit of review in case you don't remember. A vector space is a set of things that are equipped with addition and scalar multiplication. Right. This includes vectors in like 3D. You know, like velocity vectors. Can anybody else give me another example of a vector space? Oh my gosh! Please, after last week. Polynomials, right? If I add together a polynomial, I get another polynomial. If I scale a polynomial by a scalar multiple, I get another polynomial, and so on. And of course, in a vector space, there's a special element, which is a zero vector, which is, you can understand, is no displacement, no force, whatever. Right? Okay, so notice so far we haven't involved coordinates at all, right? The vectors are just some, like, they could be like literally arrows sitting in space, and as long as I have some rule for scaling them, adding them together in a consistent fashion, I'm doing okay. But of course, you know, when we get down to pencil and paper, we want to be able to do actual arithmetic with these objects, and for that, we use a basis, right? So a basis is some set of vectors that spans a vector space. In other words, I can take any point in my vector space, any vector v, and write it as a linear combination of my basis. So here, v1 and v2, because I'm a two-dimensional space, yeah? And hopefully, this notation here looks familiar, right? That any vector v can be written as a sum of the basis vectors bi with weights ci. Right. Does everybody follow so far? I think this notation is pretty familiar. Cool. All right. So now, you know, this is too simple, so we need to add some notation on top of it to make our lives harder. So that's what we're going to do. In particular, by the way, for today we're going to deal with just 1, 2, 3, and 4-dimensional linear algebra. So oftentimes you'll see things like this rather than sigma notation because that's kind of enough. Okay, so let's say that I have a vector v and I write it in the v basis. That's what I've done on the first line here. Then I can write it in a really slick way, right? Like, let's say that I made a matrix whose columns were the v's. Yeah. Then notice what I do. If I do this matrix vector product, right? Remember how matrix vector product works? I go left to right on the left hand side and top to bottom on the right hand side. Yep, so I get b1 c1 plus b2 c2 plus b3 c3, which is exactly b. Yeah? So this funny expression here is just a fancy way to write down a vector b. Yeah? And the reason it's kind of nice is it separates out the basis for my space from the coordinates. Yeah? Is this boring or what? So another way of writing it down is this expression here. So I'm going to think of this capital B as the matrix of basis vectors. And for now, like, maybe you think of these columns as numbers, or maybe you just think of them as vectors. You don't even worry about what the columns are. But we're going to always use capital letters to talk about matrices. And now if we're going to try and experiment with notation from Steve Gorka's textbook, where there's bold and there's things with arrows. Yeah. So here we're going to think of bold vectors as tuples of numbers, right? So like C1, C2, and C3. And we'll think of things as arrows as the geometric objects, like vectors. Right? And so what this is saying is if I take a basis and I multiply it by a set of coefficients, I get a vector. This notation kind of makes some sense. So this is like a little more persnickety than linear algebra notation, because we're really trying to be consistent about what's a point, what's a vector, what's a basis, and so on. Cool? All right. So when we talk about matrices, oftentimes we think about them like linear transformations, right? Linear transformations do a lot of things. They can rotate, they can scale, they can reflect, they can shear. Can they translate? Can I come up with a matrix that when I multiply it by like x, y, z, it gives me x plus 1, y plus 1, z plus 1? No, I see a couple of things like this.
Major seas can rotate, translate, scale, reflect, shear, but they cannot translate. Did I say translate in there? I did. Major seas can't translate. Sorry. So everybody repeat after me. Major seas cannot translate points. Excellent. Okay, so if you see it on your nanoquiz, right, this is like the level, now you guys can kind of see the level. Nanoquiz, that would be the kind of thing I'd use. I was like, gotcha, right? And if you don't get that right, it's your fault. Yeah. So in general, when we talk about linear transformations, right, that's like this fancy notation L, they satisfy two axioms, right? Namely, if I apply a linear transformation to the sum of two things, I get the sum of the linear transformations. If I scale a vector, then I can get that as the scaling of the linear transformation. Notice that this implies that the linear transformation applied to the zero vector equals the zero vector. Does anybody see how you could argue that? It's like almost a tautology, but not quite. Close. So you might return to this axiom here, right? Obviously, we get the zero vector by multiplying anything by zero. Well, I can pull that out, and now I get zero. Okay. So we have this fancy notation here, which is this little arrow with this doodad on this left-hand side, which is one way to understand what a linear transformation is. It says, the way that you read this is, it maps from V to L of V. Okay, that's how you say it. Yeah? And if you're taking an algebra class, that would be kind of the starting point for all these commutative integrals. That's not for us. Okay. So, something that I think gets muddled together a little bit in algebra class is that I say linear operator, you say matrix, right? And that does happen to be true in finite dimensional spaces. In infinite dimensional spaces, it's not true. So a linear operator is anything that satisfies these two axioms. So for example, I'll give you a linear operator that you can't write as a matrix, which is the one that goes from a function f to its integral from 0 to 1, right? If I take a function, and if I add two functions together, I get the sum of their integrals. If I scale a function, I get the scale of its integral. Yeah, this is a linear operator, but it's not clear what the matrix would be. Yeah? You could come up with a kind of a matrix analog, but it's not a matrix. Yeah, so the important is to kind of separate that in your head, that linearity plus finite dimensional things equals a matrix vector. And in fact, we'll prove that right here. Yep. So let's say that I have a vector v, and I write him in a basis, right? So I write, remember that I'm going to write v, I'm already going to screw this up. So I'm going to write v in the v basis, and now I'm going to apply a linear transformation to that. So I'm going to have L of v, obviously, just by equality, this is L of the sum ci. Bi, right? All I did was plug this guy in. Yeah. And remember by linearity, I can pull out sums and I can pull out scalars. Yeah? So in other words, this is equal to the sum of Ci L of Bi. But what did I learn? I learned that if I can write a vector in a basis, and I know L applied to the set of basis vectors, then effectively I know L for any vector. You see that? So this linearity property is really strong, right? What it says is that I actually only need a bunch of pairs bi, L of b, I, and that this completely determines my linear operator. Yeah? Okay, so, and that's what connects us to matrix vector properties. We'll see in a moment. Yeah? So, in other words, what did we prove? We showed that if I have a vector that I write in this kind of fancy notation here, and I apply L to it, then effectively I apply L to the three basis vector. So you write that. You guys now hopefully kind of can start to parse this notation. Right? A vector written this way gets mapped to a vector written that way. And you can see that, because you see that it's the sum of the CIs times the L. Any questions? Good. All right. This is about when my dyslexia kicks in, and now I'm going to start getting all the matrices. Okay. So, what is L of Bi? It's just another vector, right? So in linear algebra, we like kind of take this incestuous approach to math, right? We just keep writing stuff in the same basis as many times as we can, right? And so in particular, we already have a basis for my vector space. We'll assume that L is a linear operator from the space onto itself, right, as opposed to like from R3 to R2. Yeah. So in other words, I can take L of bi, and I can write this thing, which is just a vector. Let's write it down. And because it's a vector, I can write it in a basis, right? So in particular, I can write L of bi is himself equal to the sum of let's make sure that I get this right. Well, let's say this is sum over j, because we already have an I here, of j, I, b, j. You guys see what I did here? All I did was I said, well, L is a linear operator, so if I apply L, I mean, L is an operator from my vector space into itself, so I can take the output of L and write the output in the basis again, and I'm going to call the coefficients in that basis these n's. You can see I'm already going to get confused. We'll see with the slides, which I'm pretty sure are correct. And if you guys catch me making a mistake, feel free to stop me. Okay. So let's say that I write L of B1 as this sum here. I do the same thing for B2 and B3. Yeah. Then of course I can write L of B1, B2, and B3 as this product here. Do you guys see that? Do you guys see what's going on here? So for instance, if I multiply B1 times M11, B2, M21, B3, M31. Right, I get L of B1, which is the definition. Yep. So again, the trick in linear algebra is I have a basis and I'm just going to keep throwing it at my problem. Right. So what did I do? Well, I started with the basis and I wrote V in that basis. I expanded L on that basis. Now I notice that these are also vectors in the same space. I'm going to write them in the same basis. I'm just going to keep plugging stuff into the same set of vectors. Okay. Right. So now for our next trick, let's put everything together. So remember that one way to understand our linear math now is that it takes b1, b2, b3, right, and maps it to the product of these first two terms, right? That's what we just did in the previous slide. And now, so if I take a vector in the B basis, that's like taking this matrix and multiplying it by a set of coefficients, and I can just glue that on to the right answer. So now you can see that really what's going on, one way to understand a linear operator is that it's taking a vector which is written in basis times coordinates and mapping it to basis times matrix times coordinates. Okay. So usually I think in linear algebra class you think of a linear operator like that, like C to M times C, but implicitly on the left hand side we're writing it in that set of vectors. Does everybody kind of understand the argument that we made there? Okay.
Yeah, let me close G-chat. It keeps popping up.
Okay. So there's two ways to kind of interpret what's going on here. And that depends on whether you take this BMC expression on the right-hand side and couple it two different ways. So you could write it B times M times C. This is this kind of bold C. Or you could write it as B times MC. Right? I could just group it two different ways. And remember we have those two different interpretations of what's going on transformations, right? They're either transforming the coordinates or you're transforming the points. Well, notice that's exactly what's going on here, right? If I group on the left-hand side, I'm changing the basis from B to BM and keeping the coordinates the same. On the right-hand side, I'm transforming the coordinates and keeping the basis the same. And these are two different ways to interpret the same matrix M, which is why if I just give you like a matrix of numbers, it's a little hard to know what it's doing, right? This is all just a heavy way of saying that, like, I can't just give you a matrix and say use that matrix in geometry. You have to give it a context. Like this matrix inputs this and outputs that. Right? That's the way you should think about matrices. Cool? Alright. So for one thing, there's lots and lots of fast algorithms for doing linear algebra, doing matrix vector multiplies and so on. And so essentially, this like formulation that we wrote down is just a convenient way to keep track of your current basis and coordinate system for a graphics stuff. And so dealing with things like change of basis is really critical in the computer graphics world for understanding the relationship between the world, the car, the arm, the hand, all these different things in the scene. Notice that this is exactly the same math we did last week to convert, for example, from Bezier to B splines and back. Right? In that case, we had sort of the spline, what, the coordinates, the spline basis, and the coefficients. It's exactly the same. The typical issues, and when you do homework too, you're no doubt going to run into it, at least I did, that maybe you guys are better bookkeepers than I am, is remembering when you need M and when you need M inverse, and kind of keeping track of where you are. Right? And so my advice to you guys, because matrix vector notation is a little bit kind of funny to think about, notice the way that my arrows are drawn. Right? You think of a matrix, and the way that I would literally, like, I would keep on a piece of paper when I'm writing down systems like this, is this matrix takes in points in this coordinate system and outputs points in that coordinate system. And notice what that means is the input goes on the right of the matrix vector multiply, right? That's V. And it gets mapped to AV, which comes out of the left. Okay. And this is just, I think, the easiest way to think about matrix vector multiply. So this is like a piece of code that takes vectors in one space and maps them to vectors in another. And that will help you get the order of the inverse. Yeah. Okay. So let's give that a shot. I'm excited. Alright, so let's say that I have two different bases A and B. Right? So these are two different, you know, sets of, you know, for example, pairs of vectors, you know, that span the same space. By the way, nothing in our math so far assumes that our bases are orthogonal, right? They don't have to be perfect. And again, I can write the coordinates of A in B, right? Because they're in the same space. This would be like I have Bezier and B spline, and I want to convert from one to the other, exactly the same. And try and connect to last week a little bit. So in other words, I can write A1 in the B basis using this kind of a product. So in other words, I can write A equals B times M. Does everybody kind of parse this matrix notation? Then notice, obviously, if I multiply both sides by M inverse, then I have this relationship here, which essentially tells me that if I know how to go from one basis to another, I know how to go back, assuming that M is invertible, which is true any time that they span the same space. Okay. Again, I think all of this stuff you guys intuitively know and have seen before, and then I'm going to push you in front of OpenGL and you're going to get it wrong. I guarantee you. That's just what happens in this stuff. Okay, so let's say that I have a vector in the coordinate, you know, in the B coordinates, right? So I can write B. Notice that V has a hat on it because it's a vector equals the matrix times the set of coefficients. By the way, the old version of this slide, but like whoever made them kind of messed up the hats and the bowl, which made this completely confusing. So I tried to fix it. If there was ever a mistake, let me. And now the question is, what are the coordinates in the A basis? Well, remember that we have A times M inverse equals B. So I can just plug that in right here. Yeah, and what do I get? I get that V equals A M inverse C. And now, of course, if I group this way, I get the coordinates in the A basis. Yeah? So the coordinates in the A basis are M inverse C. You can see where it's easy to flip. The order of matrix multiplies is easy to flip when you have an inverse and when you don't. Just remember that. What does M do? It takes in a vector and it writes it, you know, it does a particular transformation in the B basis, and then you'll create that. Okay. All right. Right. So remember that the matrices express linear transformations. One more time. Everybody repeat after me. Translation is not linear. I love teaching. In particular, let's say that I had a function f of p that goes from p to p plus some constant vector t. Notice that if I take p and I scale it, right, then f of that is ap, you know, plus t. That's not the same as factoring that a out, right, because that t didn't get the a next to it as well. So that's enough to show you that it's not a. Okay. Alright, so we talked about vectors. Now our next object that we have to talk about is points. We're going to add even more kind of goofy notation, right? So far we have vectors, other things with the arrows on top. We have bold things for coordinates. And now we're going to add things with tildes on top. So a point is a location, whereas a vector is a displacement, right? So adding vectors is meaningful, adding points is not meaningful. I think we've already talked about it. Okay. So points are going to take us from linear problems to affine problems. And so an affine transformation, for example, is one that can translate and do something linear. Yeah? And that's what we're really after in computer graphics, right? When we change coordinate systems, like when I move a rigid object, I have to rotate it, potentially scale it, and I have to put it into place. Yeah? And it's that third piece that we're missing so far. So to do that, right, then we're going to have to talk about moving points. So in particular, we have to talk about points. So I'm going to denote a location in space rather than a displacement using this tilde. Right? Notice again, in linear algebra, we take all of these different things and just write them all this way. We're going to separate them. Okay. So, one of the really cool things is we can keep track of points in a coordinate system using almost the same notation that we've already developed so far. Right? So, if I want to have a point, one way to understand it is if there's some origin location plus a displacement from that origin.
I think this is the picture we all have in our head, right? You have some location in space here, plus, you know, some direction, you know, some motion along x and some motion along y, whatever. So the fancy way to write that is at a point, which is, remember, a tilde object, equal to an origin, plus a linear combination of vectors. And so one kind of slick way to write it is if I add as a fourth column to my set of vectors, the origin, right? So I'm going to have the basis here and the origin, so we have arrow, 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 tilde. Then I can write this relationship as C1, C2, C3, just like we had before. And we're going to cheat a little bit and put a 1 here. So this is 1 times a point. I know we're not supposed to scale points, but scaling with my 1 is OK. So 1 times a point plus this linear combination gives you any position in space. Everybody understand this notation?
Yeah.
Nice. Cool. All right. Notice, what did I do? I had 3 coordinates before, and now we have 4, but the fourth coordinate is always 1. And that's going to be our cheap trick. And why is that kind of cool? By the way, what is the coordinate if I had a vector? What would be the fourth coordinate of a vector? 0, right? Because if I put a 0 here, then I'll just get some linear combination of vectors. Yeah? Well, remember, what happens if you subtract 2 points? What do you get? You get a displacement, right? You get a vector, right? That's like the arrow from one thing to another. And notice what happens. You have 1 minus 1, you get 0. So this notation is kind of nicely consistent with that story. Right? So in particular, you know, if you subtract 2 points, you get a vector. If you add a vector to a point, right, so you displace a point, right, then you get 0 plus 1 in that fourth coordinate, and it stays 1, so it stays a point. So sort of get this nice binary notation. Yeah. Cool so far? Everybody cool? We got tildes, we got arrows, we got bold letters, we got capital letters. This is heavy stuff. All right, so when we talk about an origin plus a basis, right, so like this point coupled with these directions, we call that an affine frame. And we can write any point in space, point, not vector, in space, as the origin plus a displacement. Yeah? And we're going to use the coordinates C to express that point as a displacement. Cool? Okay. So we're going to keep kind of adding a little bit to our story and then recap, and then adding and then recap, because I think it's easy to get backward. Right, so our summary so far is that vectors can be written in a basis. We have this nice change of basis formulas. We can also write points in a frame if we add the origin as kind of a fourth column here and keep the coefficient as 1. Okay. So the transformation that we think is linear, but it's not, is when you do something linear plus you have a translation, and that is called an affine transformation. Yeah. And so essentially one way to think about it is that you're moving the origin and then doing something linear. Or vice versa, I turn the order different. Or you can do something linear and then move the origin. Yeah? That's sort of what you need in a graphic system, right? Like, what do I do when I rotate the arm? I rotate it and then I attach it to your body. Right? So those are the two things that we need. And how do you think we're going to write down an affine transformation? How do we express that in the language of development? A matrix. And how big is that matrix? Somebody other than Rafael? 4x4. Yeah. Right. And it looks something like this. Yeah. So in particular, let's say that I wrote down this heavy-duty transformation here. That takes a point, remember I write a point as origin plus displacement, and maps it to this, the same basis times a matrix times these coordinates. Right, so I'm going to write it in this fashion here. And let's expand this notation a little bit. Notice that I'm going to always keep the bottom row at 0, 0, 0, 1. Just for now. Later on, we'll expand it. Yeah. Right. So first of all, notice that it takes points to points, right? Because it leaves, right, if you look 0, 0, 0, 1, then what you get is the coordinates of the last row here. Well, you're guaranteed to get a 1, because everything else gets zeroed out. Otherwise, you'd be adding another stuff. But it allows you to carry out translation. So it produces valid frames, which is a good thing. So let's talk about the different pieces of this matrix. And typically what we do is we kind of understand the matrix in this 3x3 block, this vector, and this 0, 0, 0, 1. And they all act in kind of separate ways. So let's say that I'm given a linear transformation of my basis, right? Then it would look like this. Yeah. And so if I wanted to do a linear transformation on my basis, but leave my space alone, right? I could encode that by using this matrix here.
Right, what this matrix says is leave the fourth column alone of a vector and just translate, you know, just mess with the first 3x3 block. Yeah? So all this is effectively doing is saying, if I want to go from this point to that one, so I apply L to the B's and just leave the origin out of it, then I can write that using this notation. Everybody follow? So far I haven't done anything. All I've done is just add the origin of that to my problem. This is where stuff gets confusing. Okay. Alright. Now let's say that I wanted to express a translation. How do you guys think we're gonna do that? So what will be in this upper 3x3 block?
Zeros.
Not quite zeros, so zero still found. One's on the diagonal, that's a special name. It's diagonal, it's also called the identity.
Right.
And so effectively, what we're going to realize is that this fourth column here is controlling the translation. Okay. So, for instance, let's say that I wanted to write down the transformation that just translates points in my space, so that maps from P to P plus a translation vector. Yeah. Notice I can write my translation vector in the B basis. Right. That's my game here. I'm going to keep writing everything in the same basis. Yeah. Just like our colleague here. By the way, what's your name? I should start asking people for names.
Magnus.
Just like Magnus suggested to us, the upper 3x3 block is the identity matrix, right? So that effectively leaves these three coefficients alone. And then notice what happens. I get 1 times C1, 0, 0, plus 1 times 1, comma 4, right? So I'm effectively just adding this number because that 1 is there. So this is a translation. Okay. So in general, if we combine, this motion applied to, you know, this linear thing applied to the basis and then translate, then that's effectively just putting all this together into one matrix. Cool? All right. So this is just a big notational trick for combining a linear action and then translating. Yeah, that's all this is doing. The linear part is the upper 3x3 block, and then the translation is these three coordinates. Yeah, and if you do this 4x4 multiplication, the reason you get translation is because you're always multiplying this 4th by 4. Okay. All right. By the way, notice that if I have a vector, so I put a 0 here, what does that do? Effectively, just 0 out this 4th column, and it's just understanding this 3x3 thing. So inside of here, I can also understand how to act on vectors, not just act on elements. Yes?
So does that mean, like, the lower row is, like, always
0, 0, 1. For now. Yeah. we're gonna return to that later and interpret that later. But for now, it's always 0, 0, 0, 1. And this is defined to be an affine transformation. And that's going to be true. That's just always true. Yes?
Can you go back to what was the identity matrix?
Uh-huh.
What was the point of that again? What was happening here?
Sure. So this is the mapping from points to translated points. Right? And I want to be able to express that as a matrix vector product. Remember that we're writing vectors now, like we're writing, sorry, this is where the word vector is going to get overloaded. A matrix coordinate product, I should say, right? So we're going to think of coordinates of a point as, you know, the displacement from the origin, and then we're just going to stick a 1 on the end. So if we want to translate that point, well, what do I want to do? I want to just add, you know, t1, t2, and t3 to these three coordinates up here. So how do I do that? I can understand it as identity, and then add the coordinates of the translation t on the fourth column here, and notice what happens. I get C1 plus M14, C2 plus M24. Right. So this matrix acting on this coordinates is going to give me. In fact, let's just do it rather than talking through it here. What is it going to give me? If I do that product, I'll get. So this is effectively mapping C1, C2, C3, 1. Map to what? C1 plus and what do I get in the fourth one? What do I get in the fourth?
Yes?
One. What? Right? So this is just if I did that matrix vector product there. So notice that as a transformation, this thing takes points in this coordinate and translates them by this thing. So now I can encode translation. Assuming that I always put a 1 there for the fourth coordinate of a 1. And notice that it takes a 1 to a 1. Okay. Any other questions? I see a lot of talking, so there must be questions. Okay. Alright.
Right. So remember in our notation, if we subtract points, we get vectors. So this is just like a slick way to understand what's going on. Or if I add a point to a vector, I get another point. So all these things kind of work out nicely. Yeah. Okay. So if I take a vector and I multiply it by this 4x4 matrix, I notice that I get another vector because it zeros out that fourth column. Yeah. So in other words, this is an extension of the notation that we had before. Right. So right. And so the way to understand that is, you know, if I have a car that's moving, right, and I translate the car, obviously the coordinates of all the points in the car change, but the coordinates of the velocity of the car don't change if I just translate the car. Yeah? And so that's effectively expressed in this relationship here. Okay? By the way, if you're totally lost and confused and backward on this stuff, it's the kind of thing where if you just try a few examples, which we're going to do on homework 2, you'll see that it's really not that complicated. It's just a lot of bookkeeping. These 4x4 matrices are just a nice way to combine linear transformation plus a shift. That's all it's doing at the end of the day. Okay. Alright, so when we talk about hierarchical modeling, effectively we want to keep track of a lot of coordinate systems, and what that means is combining all these matrices together. Right? And so for instance, let's say that I want to rotate the wheel of the moving car, and I have a bunch of different frames. Right? I have the frame of the world, I have the frame of the car, I have this rotation transformation that I want to apply to the wheel. And so what do I have to do? I have to do them in the right order. And so remember that I talked about thinking about matrices as kind of inputting things and outputting things? Yeah? So when I'm doing this kind of stuff, typically the way that I might do it would be to say, okay, you know, maybe I have a matrix A that goes from world, from car to world, so that would be, you know, if I have V is in car coordinates, then I can say A, V is in world coordinates, and then maybe this is the transform world, this is the transform car. So anyway, let's see, what was I trying, what was I going? So let's say I take the world around the car and I want to apply some transformation to it, right? Like I want to take the world around the car and I want to shift that whole world to the left a little bit, right? But I have the coordinates of a point in the car, okay? Then if I want to see what happens to the coordinates of the point in the car in that frame, what do I have to do? I have to apply the transformation to go to the world coordinates. Then I can apply the transformation. And notice these all get popped onto the left-hand side. This is where things get confusing. Now I can apply the transformation to the world. Well, now if I want it in the car coordinates, I have to kind of undo what I did before. Yeah. And so when I see this kind of expression, A inverse times transformation times a transformation times A, this is what we call a similarity transformation. And effectively what it's saying is change coordinate system to the one where the matrix S makes sense, apply S, and then change back. Yeah. Okay. So in general, when we apply transform, we have to be very careful. As you can see, I already got myself confused in terms of what order they get applied. So let's say that I want to scale and then translate. Right? So a scaling matrix would be like 2, 2, 1, right? Because it doesn't translate at all. These are planar coordinates. You're going to have 3 by 3 matrices instead of 4 by 4. Yeah? So a scaling matrix would be this guy on the right-hand side. Hope you all see that. And a translation matrix might be something like this, 3, 1. So I want to scale and translate. Remember, what does that mean? That means I have a vector, I apply the scale, and then I apply the translation. So it doesn't read left to right, it reads right to left. Okay? And so at the end of the day, this is the composition I get. By the way, do you think I'll get the same thing if I apply it in the other order? No. Yeah? And that's why your next homework is going to be a giant headache, right? Because if you get any of these things backward, you're going to get garbage instead of the shape that you want it to make, which is exactly why we make it the way that we do. Yeah? Okay. So in general, you get two different things. In fact, here we even work out the coordinates of these two different problems. Cool. Okay. Right. So our next and final task for today is to talk about homogeneous coordinates. And that is kind of a way to explain that one that's kind of hanging out in the end of the connection. Yeah. We're going to we're going to allow things that aren't just zeros or ones to appear. Right? Okay. So, right, so this fourth coordinate is going to be useful for one additional transformation that we care about a lot, specifically computer graphics, and this is a camera transformation. Okay? So this goes from, for example, coordinates of a point in 3D to coordinates of a point in the frame of your camera, like along the pixels that you see. And notice that that's a weird transformation, right? The rims of parallel train tracks in 3D, and I take a photo of them. Do I get parallel train tracks in my photo? No, they tend to converge, right? And so that kind of change in geometry indicates that there's something more than just linear stuff going on, right? If I take parallel lines and I apply linear transformation to them, I get another parallel lines. So this is in fact something called a homogeneous coordinate. Okay. So the idea of homogeneous coordinates is a really, really fun area of math, and I'll try not to get too excited because I know you guys don't care, but I care. So the idea of coordinates, of homogeneous coordinates, is if I have the two-dimensional projective plane, so like two-dimensional homogeneous space, you need three coordinates. So if I need 3D stuff, then I need four coordinates, which we just saw. And the idea here is that I'm going to write my points in homogeneous space in kind of a funny way. I'm going to have the first n minus 1 components, and then a semicolon, and then the last guy. Right? So like x, y, semicolon, w, or in 3D, it'll be x, y, z, semicolon, w. Cool? And we're going to put an equivalence relationship that says any time that two points are multiple of each other by any c other than 0, they're actually the same point. Okay? So this is going to be, this is the what we call homogeneous space. It's the set of all triplets modulo the relationship that if you can write two triplets as multiples of each other, then they're actually the same. Okay, so we're going to think of this like lines to the origin. By the way, we're just going to cut out 0, 0, 0 and say that that's not a point of homogeneous. Okay, so first of all, let's convert a point x, y to homogeneous coordinates. How do you think we do that? Anybody have any suggestions? Three coordinates now. Yes. Yeah, just pop one. So that is the point x, y in homogeneous coordinates. That's good conversion. By the way, somebody else give me the coordinates of the same point in homogeneous that the coordinates that the homogeneous one. Yes?
X, y.
Yeah. Two and x, two, y, two. Right? These are the same point. Might not look that way, but yeah. Or, in fact, one that we don't think about much, which is fun, for example, let's see, put a minus one. Yeah? So all of these points in homogeneous points are considered the same. Yes?
Does that imply if you have like 2x, 2y, colon 1?
That won't be the same. Yeah, that's some other point.
Scale?
Yeah, it would be the scaling of that point, which is different from this, which is actually the same, because I can divide out. Okay. So now let's do the inverse of this. So let's say that I have 1, 5, 1. I don't know why I'm writing that ones. What is that in just normal coordinate system? 1, 5. Yeah. Similarly, if I have 12, -6, 3. What is that in? 4, -2. And I'll let you do the third one as an exercise. Okay. So hopefully you get the name of the game here. That if I want to convert back from homogeneous coordinates to just normal usual coordinates, it's very easy to do. I just divide by the third guy here. Except in one case, what is that? If that's 0, it's not okay with that. And so in fact, I actually secretly added a point to my space that we didn't have before, which is x, y, 0. Remember, that makes sense, because if we think about these like positions, right, then x, y, 0 corresponds to a vector, and what is this going to argue? It says, well, if I scale by anything other than 0, nothing happens at this point. But if I want a 0 in that fourth slot, I get something fundamentally different as a vector. It's kind of nice. Okay. Right, so the idea of homogeneous coordinates, you add an extra dimension. So in 2D, you have 3 coordinates, and 3x3 matrices, in 3D, you have 4 coordinates, and 4x4 matrices. Yeah. And now we're going to allow that fourth coordinate w to have any arbitrary value instead of just one. Yeah. So for all transformations except for perspective, by the way, it's perfectly fine to take just w to be 1 and to have the last row of your matrix be 0, 0, 0, 1, and you won't ever lose anything. Okay. By the way, something you might notice is that there's points x, y, 0, right? And what is that? What is the right way to think about x, y, 0? it's a little bit of a philosophical question, but the way that I like to think about it is that those are directions. They're actually not quite vectors, but they're directions. So in particular, let's say that I take x, y, 1, right? So this is a point in space, and I just scale it by constant c, like that. Yeah? Well, obviously, as c gets bigger, what happens? I keep moving farther and farther in the x, y direction, right? And I just draw a line through that and go farther. But notice I could write this in a different way, right? I could say this is x, y, yeah? And notice in this notation, if I take c to be bigger, 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 I mean, effectively, this doesn't change. And this number goes to 0, yeah? So one way to think about coordinates x, y, 0 is that they're what we call points at infinity, which are points that are like infinitely far away, right? I just keep scaling, scaling, scaling out in different directions, right? That's not the same as like minus x, y, 0. Yeah? So you can have different points at infinity depending on what direction you just looked in and kept popping. By the way, if you're a mathematician and you want something that might bother your brain a little bit if you haven't seen it before, what happens if I go in the minus x, minus y direction? Well, effectively, eventually I'll get minus x, minus y, comma 0, if I go far enough now. But remember that all these points are the same up to scale. So minus x, minus y, 0 is the same as x, y, 0. So in other words, if I go far enough out in this direction, where do I end up? I actually wrap back around the plane. So I'll let you think about that a little bit. So this is a topology problem. So if I ask you, what is the topology of the projected plane? Remember, topology is all about connectivity. You can actually get to the bottom left by going far up onto the upper left. Anyway, just something to bug your mind a little bit. Okay. Anyway, so why do we need homogeneous coordinates? Well, hopefully, actually, you guys can see the story a little bit just from this ugly picture of fish. Right? That notice that sort of as I move farther and farther out, right? As I move my camera, so like I have my eye here and I'm observing things through a photograph. It's kind of, you can think of it like sitting on this plane. Right? What happens if I move farther and farther away from the eye? Effectively, the plane of my camera gets bigger. I think we all know that, right? I mean, I can take a photo of a mountain by standing far away from it. Yeah? Right, and so effectively, what happens is I divide by that w. I think of w kind of like depth, right? And so what happens is the farther out, the bigger this width is. And so I have to kind of shrink it back to sit on my camera frame. And that's what perspective transformation is. Yeah? So let's think about, so this picture is kind of hard to interpret, so let's go down a dimension. Yeah? Let's say that I'm in a camera here, and my camera's looking through this plane. And I draw two lines, right? So I see some feature, x, comma, z. So z is like how far away it is from my camera, and x is how far across I am. And I want to know, and now I think of my camera as imaging on this plane. In other words, I could take this line and kind of divide it into little pixels, and draw a ray through one of those pixels until it hits an object, and that's the thing that I draw on the screen. Yeah? And the question is, what are the coordinates at this point in my photograph? Well, what do I do? Well, assuming that this is distance 1, I just divide by the depth, and that gives me the location on this plane. And you get that because if you draw this triangle and this triangle, they're similar, right? They have the same angles. So effectively, I just scale stuff to move. Does that make sense? So in other words, from the perspective of my camera along this line segment here, x comma z and x divided by z comma 1 are the same. Do you see that? Because my camera can't see depth, right? So what does this look like? Well, this is exactly a projective transformation, right? And the difference between projective stuff and linear is a projective goes out in a cone, whereas linear transformation just takes space and kind of shear it and keep lines parallel. Yeah. Okay. So another way of putting that is the homogeneous coordinates of this thing are x over z 1, 1 in my camera plane. You're one of those, like the second one we're not really showing, that would be like out of the morning. Yeah. And a different way of writing it is to put depth there, which is what we want. Yeah. Okay. Right. So if we want to talk about projective transformations, now we're going to start sneaking things places that we didn't have them before. Right? So probably what I would do, I disagree with these slides slightly. I would actually just chop out the second row of this matrix. Right? So this would be like a 2x1 thing, because effectively I now have a one-dimensional image plane. But anyway, regardless, I have a point x, comma z. And I map it into a coordinate system where effectively I'm dividing my z. And that's what it, what's going to allow me to move yes, yes. And so, in other words, essentially what we're doing, you know, is we're dividing by W, which in this case we're thinking about kind of like depth, to project into the plane, which we're always going to, we can always think of the plane of your image as W equals 1. Okay. So we call this projective equivalence. And so for affine transformations, we already kind of argued that W equals 1 is enough, but is the camera transformation affine? How many of us vote yes? How many of us vote no? How many of us are just not going to vote? Completely lost. Have questions? Alright, ask questions. Like, you should stop me if you're lost. Right, so no, this is not affine. Affine keeps parallel stuff parallel. Remember, it takes all the space and it can just rotate, translate, and shoot. Yeah? Whereas the camera transformation takes parallel train tracks and turns them into a wedge that goes, you know, into some point in the connection. Yeah? And it does that by dividing by W. And so, this is the real kind of showcase of the piece of all this projective math. Right? The reason why we like 4x4 matrices is that they allow us to not only do rotation, shearing, and translation when they're 4x4, but they also allow us to do camera transformation by essentially putting z, right, the depth from the camera, in that fourth coordinate that used to just be 1. Right? And when you do that, then effectively you're dividing out by z, and that's what's bringing everything up into the image. Cool? All right. So it's kind of a fun example of a problem that can make use of this as just rendering. One of the kind of fun ones that was proposed a few years ago is something called phototourism. The idea was, if I'm given a bunch of photos in a scene, I'm trying to figure out where they're taken and get 3D geometry that kind of reconstructs the scene from all the photos. And obviously if I want to do that, then I need to understand the camera transformation of every single photo and the camera transformation of one image relative to another. Right? And so the basic parts of this algorithm, by the way, you're not responsible for like the details of this technique. If you're interested, take the computer vision class. But roughly what they do is they say like, oh, well, I've got two photos of the same fountain in Europe. Maybe I can identify some points that are the same in these two images. And that gives me some constraint on the camera transformation from one to another. Right? Because it says the camera transformation takes this blue point to that blue point, for example. And if you have enough of these, you can actually compute the camera transformation. If you want to learn the details of how this is done, you should take 6815 or whatever the computer vision class is now. I know they changed numbers here a lot. And then solve a problem called structure from motion, which says, given these different correspondences between the different images, try and figure out the location of the actual camera. And so at the end of the day, the kind of cool thing, hopefully we can see this in action. Also, you can see what, you know, Twitter used to look, or you know, Flickr used to look like. You guys even born when this? Right, so they download like a bunch of photos of some common thing. And so what they get is some, you know, for example, 350 images of the same thing, which they put into correspondence. You can see that the color charts are kind of the same feature. And then what they can do is actually reconstruct the scene. So the idea is that they figure out all the different camera transformations that are kind of like little wedges that sit in space, right? These are like the camera plane that can move out from the space. And eventually, now you can move around in the 3D scene, and this allows you to do things like, you know, figure out the relationship between different photos. So hopefully in a second, we'll let Noah talk. So the really cool thing in something like this is that none of the display things here are 3D. These are just 2D images, and all they're doing is kind of averaging between different projective transformations to move from one to another. Right? So they're just kind of warping these photographs using exactly the math that we talked about to move your camera from one position to another. Yes?
Is this the basis of things like the SLAM algorithm?
SLAM? I think SLAM typically assumes that you have the same camera, or like not very many of them. You're moving around a scene and registering, but it's certainly the same kind of class of challenges. So SLAM is simultaneous localization in motion, which is kind of where you place your robot inside the scene to reconstruct. And obviously there's a lot of similarities to trying to kind of find relationships between the different images. Although in that case you might have more signal because you know that your robot doesn't move too fast. Yes?
So to be able to actually figure out this, like, you have to know the FOV of every single camera? Does Flickr store like camera metadata and their images in this?
They do not. So they, I think at least they didn't start going into this paper camera. So these guys have some nice way of estimating this by having enough feature points registered from one image. Yeah. But anyway, I think the cool thing from our perspective is that just by using camera transformation, you can even see it, right? These little rectangles that are moving around are really just moving around using the transformation function. Okay, so with that, that's actually it for today. So again, when you're going home and studying this stuff, you should really keep straight in your head what's a point, what's a vector, what's a transformation, and just do a few examples of like, I'm in this coordinate system, I want to do this. And when you do homework two, you'll be able to practice this quite a bit, but on like a very heavy duty system. So in your next lecture, again, it'll be Mo. I will have access to email, key also, and all that stuff. Alright, so see you guys next week or in my office hours tomorrow. And your homework is due tomorrow night at 8 p.m. Tomorrow. Thank you guys.